Now I'm going to present a rationale and role for the SEALS LIRADS project in the International Guide Cell Arena in 2017, and which are the problems. So the recommendation of the International Guidelines for the Management of HCC is to use ultrasonography in the surveillance of patients with cirrhosis who are at risk of developing HCC. You can see here the recommendation of the European guidelines, which are in line with all guidelines. So we should use ultrasound to make an early detection of focal liver lesions. However, once the lesion is detected by ultrasound, we see different lesions like these ones. A few hypoechoic, this one, that one, this one, or hyperechoic. But unfortunately, with the ultrasound alone, we are not able to say what they are. Indeed, these were the histological confirmation. As you can see, that lesions will look pretty much the same, like this one or that one. One is hepatocellular carcinoma, biopsy confirmed, and the other was a macroregenerative nodule. So ultrasound alone is not enough to make any final diagnosis. But what sort of lesion may we found in cirrhotic patients? This is for the early detection of hepatocellular carcinoma, but at least about one-third of small lesions finally are not hepatocellular carcinoma. As you can see here, most often they are nodules of hepatocellular type, regenerative nodules which might have dysplasia, which is divided into low grade or high grade. So at least three different types of regenerative hepatocellular nodules: regenerative without dysplasia, with low grade dysplasia, or high grade dysplasia. More rarely, we meet other disease. Some are apparently focal lesions, which instead are fibrosis due to chronic liver disease. But occasionally, we might meet cholangiocarcinoma or other rare entities. This is a series for France of a few years ago. This is a series from Spain in which the authors investigated explanted livers. And they found out that about 60% were HCC. These were all patients transplanted for HCC. But as you can see, concurrently with the hepatocarcinoma that were the reasons for transplanting the patient, these patients also had other lesions, which again, in the large majority, have regenerative nodules with or without dysplasia, like high-grade dysplasia. A few lesions are hemangioma. Noticeably, you don't find here any alternative malignancy like cholangiocarcinoma or lymphoma, but this is due to the selection of patients who are candidates for liver transplantation, which exclude patients with lymphoma or cholangiocarcinoma. These are series from Italy, from our own centers. This was a prospective study conducted between the end of the 90s and the end of the 80s and end of the 90s. It was a long prospective study. These were from Bologna again, Milan, or Barcelona. So again, Spain and other centers in Italy. And briefly, to summarize, if you pick up all lesions which have arisen in cirrhosis, about any size, about 80% will finally be hepatocellular carcinoma, and the others, again, are mainly hepatocellular lesions, but not malignant. If you select only lesions which are less than 2 centimeters, like this study in Spain or this study in Milan, Italy, you see that about two-thirds, so a bit less, because this is a smaller size, are finally hepatocellular carcinoma, and the others might be cholangiocarcinoma or other benign lesion. So to summarize, we can say that after we found a focal liver lesion in cirrhosis, depending on the size, the vast majority will be hepatocellular carcinoma, which is between 65 and 67%, up to 2 centimeters, up to 85 or 95%, depending on the size. If not an hepatocellular carcinoma, most likely, most often, there are regenerative nodules with or without dysplasia. About 1 to 2% are cholangiocellular carcinoma, and less than 1% are lymphoma, hemangioma, or metastasis of other extremely rare entities. For the first time in the year 2000, in the setting of oncology overall, some guidelines recommended the possible diagnosis of a specific lesion, which is hepatocellular carcinoma. So I do not mean malignancy versus benign, but specifically a tumor of a specific line, which is hepatocellular line, to be diagnosed only by imaging. And in these guidelines, the recommendation was to use the hypervascularity. I think this slide is very, very important to understand the use of contrast imaging technique. This scheme was produced by the group of Matsui, who is a Japanese radiologist, by performing CT arteriography. It means that before resection of nodules, a catheter was put in the hepatic artery, and then the contrast agent was injected in the hepatic artery, and the CT scan was carried out. So it means that any lesions were investigated only selectively with arterial perfusion, not like we inject in the peripheral vein when the contrast goes both in the artery and the vein. And then the catheter was withdrawn, it was inserted in the splenic artery, and if you inject in the splenic artery, the contrast goes in the splenic, in the spleen, and from the spleen to the splenic vein, to the portal vein, and to the liver only through the portal system. So in doing this way, they could select lesions, whether the lesion was perfused in the arterial phase, and you can see that from regenerative nodules to large regenerative nodules, so this is like cirrhosis, in which one third of the blood supply to the parenchyma is brought by the artery and two third is brought by the portal vein. When the regeneration in cirrhosis progressed to a regenerative nodules, to dysplasia, to early foci of cancer and well-differentiated hepatocellular carcinoma and classic hepatocellular carcinoma, which is moderately or poorly differentiated, you can see that at the beginning there is a progressive decrease in the normal paired arteries. But at the time of transformation from a regenerative nodules to high-grade dysplasia and early cancer, there is an increase in the neoangiogenic arteries. These are tumoral arteries created by the cancer, and they become higher than the degree of arterial enhancement in the parenchyma. At the time, it is a well-established, mature, well-differentiated cancer. And the amount of arteries progresses with the enlargement of the lesion and usually with the decrease in tumor differentiation. So this is the pattern. As you can see, only when there is a frank overt hepatocellular carcinoma, you have an increase in the amount of tumoral arteries. At the same time, we have a decrease with the progression from cirrhosis, regenerative nodules, dysplastic nodules, cancer, and poorly differentiated cancer. We have a decrease in the portal blood supply. Clearly, this means that we have some tumors which are in the early phase, which have not yet the hyper enhancement in comparison to the surrounding parenchyma. So this means that the lack of enhancement does not totally rule out cancer, but it is more often associated with regenerative nodules, while the hyper enhancement is typical of hepatocellular carcinoma. Based on this pattern, and sorry, I go back, based on the lack of portal supply, it means that in the overt cancer, which we have also less perfusion in the portal phase, because the cancer has lost the portal vessels, because these are part of the normal parenchyma. Based on this, the first guidelines established the possibility to make a diagnosis of HCC on what they called hypervascularization. The term is not perfect, but at that time, it was not only based on enhancement. So this is why arterial hypervascularization is a word that was introduced at that time. And these guidelines recommended for the first time that if a lesion is more than 2 centimeters, and you can depict with any artery the hypervascularization, and this can be done by CT or MRI with a contrast enhancement, but also with angiography. It was endorsed also with Doppler ultrasound depicting high signal, high Doppler arterial signal. It was possible to establish a diagnosis of hepatocellular carcinoma only based on imaging. And I would like to remark that at that time, maybe the word hypervascularization was acceptable, because also angiography and Doppler were included. Later on, in 2005, the American Association for the Study of the Liver released for the first time their guidelines about hepatocellular carcinoma. The first one were released by the European Society of Liver Cancer. And these new guidelines have at least two important novelties. The first one was the hallmark for the diagnosis of HCC was the presence of hypervascularity in the arterial phase, but with washout in the portal venous phase. What does it mean? It means that in the late phase, the hepatocellular carcinoma is depicted by less enhancement than the surrounding parenchyma. And this was introduced to avoid a false diagnosis of hepatocellular carcinoma in the case of arterioportal fistulas. The second big news, was the abandoning angiography because of the false positives and introducing contrast enhanced ultrasound. So apparently we should not have any debate today because contrast enhanced ultrasound should be there since 10 years. However, in 2010, the BCLC group from Barcelona reported that in 21 cases of peripheral cholangiocarcinoma on cirrhosis, 10 of these cases showed a pattern which is consistent theoretically with ACC, because they had homogeneous hyper-enhancement in the arterial phase followed by washout, so the lesion is hypo-enhancing in the late phase. And clearly, hyper-enhancement in the arterial phase plus washout is what the ASLD guidelines recommended as diagnostic for ACC. I would like to remark, however, that these were only 10 patients over 6 years in a big case center, so it means very, very few patients. However, nonetheless, according to this potential risk of false diagnosis of cholangiocarcinoma for hepatocellular carcinoma, CEUS was questioned and became so questioned that it was dropped from the NEST guidelines. I would like also to remark that at CEUS, the pattern of rim enhancement, which is claimed to be typical of cholangiocellular carcinoma, and indeed it is, but it occurs quite less than in CT and MRI. In a multicentric study in Italy, we could confirm that indeed these are 25 cholangiocellular carcinoma in cirrhosis. There is a number of approximately more than half that they have hyper-enhancement in the arterial phase and they have washout because they are hypo-enhancing in the late phase. So just look at this figure, the frame in red highlight the number of cases that potentially are at risk of misdiagnosis of hepatocellular carcinoma in the instance of cholangiocellular carcinoma. Based on these problems of potential misdiagnosis, although the number of cases is really, really very small, because if we consider that the total number of cholangiocarcinoma is about 2% of new focal lesions in cirrhosis, and only half have the same pattern of hepatocellular carcinoma at CEUS, so it means maximum 1% of all new nodules. However, based on this, the new guidelines dropped and removed CEUS. You see that from 2011, only multiphasic CT and MRI with contrast are allowed to establish a diagnosis of hepatocellular carcinoma. And if these lesions do not achieve a diagnosis of HCC, there is no distinction between all the different cases, and biopsy is always recommended. The European guidelines in the next year follow the same line. So only CT and MRI are now endorsed. And if the lesion is not achieving a diagnosis of HCC, it should be submitted to biopsy. Which are the problems with these guidelines if we would like to follow them? The problems in the arena today are that a diagnosis of HCC is accepted only by CT or MRI, but not in all centers that are immediately available. patients may present contraindication to these techniques, like renal failure, obesity, claustrophobia, which prevent these techniques to be correctly performed or performed at all. Moreover, if there is a technical failure, the patient has breathed during the examinations and the images are moved and blurred, you cannot repeat because you should inject contrast again. So there are problems in repeating the techniques. Not all nodules are well assessed. Moreover, when HCC diagnosis is not reached by imaging because the diagnosis is atypical, these guidelines claim that biopsy is always mandatory. However, not all lesions are suitable for biopsy. Although we would like to biopsy, some cannot be biopsied because there is unsafe needle path. Maybe there are clotting disorders, there might be ascites, there might be multiple nodules, we cannot biopsy all of them, or sometimes lesions are really too tiny to be biopsied. And if the lesions cannot be biopsied and is not a typical imaging for HSC, there is no standard modality proposed to express the opinion of the imaging operators about whether the probability of HSC is high or low. So the clinician does not know how to interpret the description. Moreover, the modality of describing the findings is not standardized, and it is left to the operator, is often variable, sometimes exotic or even artistic, and a description is often not followed by a conclusion, and the clinician are left with no practical information how to manage their patients. Moreover, if the nodule is not an HSC and undergoes imaging every 3 or 4 months, since there is only HCC or not HCC, there is not a way of understand whether the lesion is progressing towards HCC, which means there is no way to understand whether it is to be submitted again to biopsy, because there are no different classes with different risk of HCC. Moreover, in the case of intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma, CT and MRI are not able to make a diagnosis, and especially are not able to distinguish benign from malignancy. And if biopsy can be performed, then everything is easy. But when biopsy cannot be performed, then theoretically the patient does not even know whether he has a benign or malignant lesion, whereas CEUS usually is not suffering this limitation. How things are moving on? Recent manuscript highlighted that maybe a more refined analysis of contrast enhancement of the target lesion may help identify non-hepatocellular malignant lesions. Therefore, to overcome all these problems, the American College of Radiology set up working groups with the aim of delivering recommendations on how to report imaging findings and to design a spectrum of probability of lesions to be HCC or benign or malignant of non-hepatocellular lesions. One of the main aims was to reduce the risk of misdiagnosis of cholangiocellular for hepatocellular carcinoma, so to identify an enhancement pattern of extremely high positive predictive value for hepatocellular carcinoma, almost totally specific, not a risk of misdiagnosis. Another aim was to provide information about the probability of a lesion to be a hepatocellular carcinoma from absent to high risk of probability among those not achieving the diagnostic criteria. And these two questions, open to the debate in 2015, have been addressed by the CEUS LIRAS working group in order to expand the use of CEUS beyond the countries currently accepting it and to increase the information provided by imaging to clinicians. So this is the status. You see already mentioned that the ASLD, the ASL guidelines removed CEUS from their diagnostic possibilities. The Korean guidelines also do not upset CEUS. The Asia-Pacific, the Japanese societies of hepatology and liver cancer accept CEUS, as well as the Italian and the Canadian Association for the Study of the Liver or Liver Cancer, and the Federation of Societies for Ultrasound in Medicine and Biology, the World Federation, the European Federation. However, I put yes in small fonts because the Japanese guidelines accept it only in second line after CT and MRI and not with full potential. So why these discrepancies? And moreover, what were the status at this time? The diagnosis of HCC was accepted, but there were no mention of the problem of non-HCC malignancy in Asia and no classes among the non-HCC lesions. Even in the Cadania guidelines, which are really well written and well done, there are no mentioning of the issues of non-hepatocellular malignancy, and there are no classes of different risk of hepatocellular carcinoma among the lesions which do not achieve a final diagnosis. So probably for the first time, the guidelines of the European federations of societies in ultrasound in medicine and biology, gathered by the World Federation and the European Federation together with other ones, highlighted the possibility to distinguish different classes of risk among lesions which do not achieve the final diagnosis of hepatocellular carcinoma. Might be depending on the enhancement. Some lesions are iso-enhancing in the portal-aided phases, some wash out. However, despite there was this description, there were not really specific classes determined. So there was still a need to set up different classes. And in the absence of these classes, the lack of different categories left the quality of the report to the wording capacity of the operator. And this makes difficult the comparison of series from different centers or different operators. So this is why the American College of Radiology convened together experts in their working groups to make a more clear classification of the imaging findings. And this is what is being now released by the American College of Radiology, that we have a class which is LR5, which is definitively HCC. There is a class which is LR1, which are lesions that we can say with certainty that they are benign, and all of them will be later illustrated by Professor Wilson. And some lesions are surely malignant, but probably not hepatocellular carcinoma. So the risk, a risk that they are hepatocellular carcinoma, but most likely there are other malignancy. And if lesions are not falling in these classes, then we have three classes of different risk of being hepatocellular carcinoma, from very low risk to intermediate probability of hepatocellular carcinoma to very high probability of hepatocellular carcinoma. So after you describe the contrast enhancement, you can conclude each nodule to which class it belongs. And clearly, for any clinician, it is more clear to say, okay, this nodule is probably in HCC, rather than stating iso-enhancing in the arterial phase with washout in the late phase. Most clinicians do not understand, but if you put in your conclusion LR4, probably hepatocellular carcinoma, this is very clear to any clinician. So one of the aims is to make a standard terminology. And this is, I think, was a very important highlight of the LIRADS groups. So today, the definitions should not be hypervascular, washing, intense arterial uptake, but in my opinion, the very clear definition for a lesion which is an hepatocellular carcinoma is arterial phase, hyperenhancement, followed by washout appearance. This is very clear. Another aim of the LIRADS was to reduce imaging interpretation, and this enhances the communication with the referring clinicians, and also patients know better what is their situation. This also, the LIRADS aim is to facilitate quality assurance and research, and to facilitate integration and correlation between imaging modalities. Another aim, and this is the final conclusion, is that there was a desire to make the diagnosis of HCC as specific as possible. So how to get rid of the risk of misdiagnosis in case of cholangiocarcinoma? In recent years, there have been a few articles dealing with the problem of the differentiation of cholangiocellular from hepatocellular carcinoma. As you can see from this study, the rates of enhancement of cholangiocellular carcinoma, which are in orange color, is lower than hepatocellular carcinoma. You see, these are the second, so this is the portal phase. So this means that cholangiocellular carcinoma have less enhancement in the late venous phase. So it means that the lesion becomes darker, more marked washout. I would like only to remark that this study, however, does not include only cholangiocellular carcinoma on cirrhosis. So the conclusions are very interesting, but are not the final conclusions of patients in cirrhosis, because we don't know whether the behavior is similar. Another issue is that lesions of non-hepatocellular type, like liver metastasis of intrahepatic cholangiocellular carcinoma, start the washout earlier than hepatocellular carcinoma. This is an Asian series, it's a very large tumor, so maybe it's not the definitive diagnosis, but it is similar to the study from Germany, which shows that in the portal venous phase, so it is earlier than the late phase, cholangiocellular carcinoma tend again to have more often already the hypoenhancement in comparison to the hepatocellular carcinoma. So earlier washout, and I think that this study is one of the ones that make the conclusive evidence that even in case of only patients at risk of hepatocellular carcinoma, because these were all patients either with cirrhosis or severe fibrosis, altogether there are 36 patients, so this is a very good group, only specifically of patients with cholangiocellular carcinoma in patients at risk. You can see that in this case, even small lesions, because altogether they were about 5 centimeters, but the authors even selected patients with analyzed patients with less than 3 centimeters. The lesions that have non-rim-like enhancement, so global enhancement, which looks like hepatocellular carcinoma, they had a mean time to wash out well below 60 seconds. And this is different from hepatocellular carcinoma. So this strongly suggested that cholangiocellular carcinoma have early washout, not only in any case like in healthy liver, but also specifically in cirrhosis. So altogether, marked washout and early enhancement, less than 60 seconds, appears to be very interesting factors and variables to distinguish cholangiocellular carcinoma from hepatocellular carcinoma. So to summarize and conclude, CIUS is differently endorsed by various international HCC societies. Most societies today endorse CIUS simply accepting a minimal risk of misdiagnosis for cholangiocellular carcinoma, so they do not mention the potential risk of misdiagnosis, since in these guidelines there are not specific criteria to define cholangiocellular carcinoma from hepatocellular carcinoma. However, rim enhancement, early washout, and marked washout are common in cholangiocellular carcinoma and rare in hepatocellular carcinoma. So this was a matter of high interest from CIUS, and it also differentiated this technique from CT and MRI, because CT and MRI are not able to make this temporal distinction, because they scan only once in the venous phase and they do not have real-time assessment. And this criterion deserved being considered to a greater extent. And in the end, since not all nodules are suitable for biopsy, it seemed that there was really a big need for a standardized classification to conclude about the degree of risk of hepatocellular carcinoma in patients who could not be submitted to biopsy. And this, again, is not mentioned by any guidelines today, and all these topics were of interest and were discussed in the CIUS LIRADS recommendations released on the ACR website. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Fabio. It was a great presentation. I have many questions from the audience, but with the interest of time, I will just limit to one question. CUS LIRADS will. Do you think CUS LIRADS will increase the implementation of CUS worldwide?
My answer is absolutely yes, because this is the only guidelines that, based on the experience to date, but data are being collected and they seems to validate these criteria, is the only imaging modality which differentiates very well cholangiocellular carcinoma from hepatocellular carcinoma, making the diagnosis very specific, and at the same time, we are not only able to make a specific diagnosis of hepatocellular carcinoma, but we are also avoiding the risk of misdiagnosis of cholangiocellular carcinoma for a benign lesions, because CT and MRI, there is no washout in cholangiocellular carcinoma, and if you cannot biopsy these lesions, there is a risk of saying that these are not malignant. So, in my view, there is a lot of importance for CEUS, and this classification will enhance the use of CEUS.
Thank you very much.